The Riches That Are is Barbershop Podcast every Wednesday night from BOXO Studio right here in the great city of Hamilton, Ontario, in the shadow of the mountain.
I had to kill your monitor in case you're wondering. I noticed you staring at it.
You're all about killing stuff.
Yeah, that's why you don't have it.
Well, good, because it's a bit self-conscious.
It was blowing out Brad's beautiful face.
You can't have that because, you know, it's all about the look and the feel of music, and yes, we are feeling and looking pretty good tonight, aren't we, Ryan Gannon?
We sure are.
What? We're at 183. You trust me on this one?
It just doesn't seem real.
It doesn't. 183, because most things you've done 183 times, you have to do some Hail Marys or something to, you know, beg forgiveness. Like you, or unless it's brushing your teeth, and that's good. And
as regular, I think there's maybe two things I've done 183 times. This is the other one.
On a weekly basis, it's a great thing. Music is alive. It's everywhere. It is from the first screechy, scratchy notes of a kid on a violin to the kind of music that make someone with dementia come alive again. It is central to the core of your brain, who you are, what you feel, what you know. Every town and every nook and cranny in this land and all the other lands have musicians, have artists, have people who are producing and giving. And quite often the only thing they lack is a forum to expose who they are to you. And because of this amazing thing called the interweb, we can now let you know what someone sounds like, what they think, what they feel. And in this case, you know, what they look like. And what they look like is pretty amazing, you know. You guys doing good there, Ryan Cannon and Gary Greenland?
We're doing fantastic.
You're doing fantastic. And I know you're waking. You love this band and you love this music. And you've got an investment in tonight sounding great.
I am invested.
He's invested heavily. Sinburn is the band, and if you haven't heard of them, you will. They are one of the bright lights in the Hamilton metal music scene. Metal, if you are a disciple or even a casual fan, can see that there are many genres of heavy, rhythmic, addictive music. This is but one of them, and these fellas do it with gusto and aplomb. We've had great pleasure working with them here, and it is my great pleasure to have them on the show tonight, Barbershop Podcast, Sinburn. And I'm going to introduce Damien, a.k.a. Squigg, and Brad Foisy on drums, our friend Dave Green, bass, and Billy Spencer on drums. Together, they are Sinburn. How are you doing tonight, guys?
Awesome. Good, man.
That's great. Okay, let's talk about music and rock and roll in general. Okay, let's start with you because it's all about the singer. We all know that, right?
Yeah.
Right off the bat. Were you a music fan or were you like a voice fan right off the bat?
No, music fan.
Right
Kiss
off
fan.
The bat, yeah.
Kiss fan from as long as I can remember.
And that's one of the things. That Kiss is right up there in the mix. It is always a band, especially at that age, combined all the magic elements to make somebody get hooked for the first time. And it's always about that first hit, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it was Kiss growing up, and alternately I had Elvis growing up because my mom was a huge Elvis fanatic. So those two realms of rock, you know, the old school and then at the time the new school, and then grew up and started gaining further exposure. So I'm a simple rock guy. I like the AC/DCs and the Kisses and the Aerosmiths, yep. And then right into the 80s with the 80s hair bands.
Yeah, because we weren't really thinking about what it was a progression of what we heard on the, and remember, this was the very early days of FM radio, of album oriented rock and roll radio, before it was a top 50 chum FM sort of thing. You had to come up with a single that was poppy and boppy, and then here became the FM, which was ignored and until these stations started playing entire, you know, album sides, or at least getting into the songs that you would never hear necessarily, or even the artists that you would never hear otherwise. And for me, it was definitely that, and like Teenage Head, you know, first time, age of 15, I saw them. That was in a high school. It's like you got to let kids experience live music, right? Let's go around the room, and let's start out right with that. Let's talk about your first early musical experience. You know, what you remember. Let's go ahead. Start with you. Oh. Don't hog the mic, though, because everyone's more interesting than you, and you know it.
First music experience. Paul Lynn Halloween special, Kiss.
Yeah.
I don't even remember how old I was, but it had to have been 76.
Yeah.
So that would have made me, I can't say.
A kid, just a wee kid. All right, Brad, yeah. Do you remember the first time music blew your face away?
Yeah, you know what? I was probably in grade 7, and I saw Thor at a high school gym. And he was the big muscular dude that
did yeah,
the water bottle and everything. And I was just blown away by that because it was just real raw, early metal at the time. And I was just totally stoked by that.
Crazy. All right, Billy, you remember your first time was on TV?
Other than listening to my mom's Bee Gees and stuff like that, I discovered Black Sabbath, Ozzy Osbourne, Led Zeppelin, Rush, and as soon as I heard Rush, I wanted to play the drums.
Yeah. It's and I see that time and time again, like the way he plays is very evocative to kids at that age. I see kids who play drums and they can comp certain people, but when they play like Neil Peart, they light up, and they yeah. Amazing job for kids anyway. All right.
With me, my sister was going to a Kiss concert at Maple Leaf Gardens, and somehow or another I got a hold of Kiss Alive and looked at that album, and it just blew my mind. I was like, it was surreal that you could actually consider doing that. You could be those guys.
Yeah.
You know, and that just blew my mind. So it's always been in me to somehow or another get to do something like that. So that was it. Definitely just her going to the Kiss concert, me, you know, kind of checking it out and seeing that cover of Kiss Alive at those people standing at Cobo Hall holding the sign doing this thing, whatever the hell that is, you know.
Crazy.
Blew my mind.
Crazy good. All right. Well, talk is cheap. Music is expensive, so we're going to bring them some of the good stuff right off the bat, and then we'll get back to the chit-chat, the nuances of what makes Sinburn, but the proof is in the pudding, and I think you guys got some pudding online for us.
Song's called Pudding, isn't it?
Song, no. It would be nice if it was. What are you going to start the night with?
We'll start with one of our songs called Scream.
Scream.
Yeah.
All right, here it is. Sinburn with Scream, live on barbershoppodcast.com.
Together, get ready to put on a show. Sound of anticipation growing. Looking across the sea of you, everything moving much too slow. Feel the anticipation growing. Stand together. Our energy becoming one and the same. Calling for hands to raise you to it. Singing a song. My brain for you to tell me the name. To hear that you definitely knew it. It's the moment when the lights come on, the drums they break. Through the tension you can cut it with the knife and you'll scream. Scream. Together, keep it going even after the show. Calling our names and we can hear it. Turn it around, cause you're not quite ready to go. Leaving it all on stage, believe it.
guitar screams into the night. Rushes swelling as I reach. Welcome in you to the band. Take my hand and go. Scream, scream, scream for you. Can you see me? Can you hear me?
Screaming is what he does for a living. You'll love it. That is Sinburn, rock and roll. And we're talking stylistically, you know, you're going to put it somewhere, you know, across a nice spectrum of music, right? You have to, and I ask this bands all the time, and you're resistant to it. It's like, who are you like? And people are like, oh, I'm kind of like Matt Damon or something. But musically, what, you know, you talk, you mentioned already a whole bunch of the bands that inspired you. And you kind of can't help but create music that comes from that well, that inspires you. But for your close friends or your family or the people who like what you like, how do you, you know, what do you sound like? What do you sound like? How do you describe your brand of metal?
I always thought it sounded a cross between Godsmack and Stone Temple Pilots.
Good
kind
one.
Of thing.
Good one.
It kind of did when I first tried out for these guys.
Yep.
So, yeah.
And what elements of Gobsmack? Because there's a band that kind of stands out in a crowd, and the melodic elements of STP or a lot of the other bands, you know, absolutely plays in there. Where you are you conscious of it? You know, I'm going to ask you about that later when it comes to writing, because sometimes it just comes out of you, and sometimes you're like, oh, let's do that kind of thing from the thing, because that worked. That worked on me. What do you tell people you guys sound like?
Actually, I'm... Godsmack for sure. I think there's a bit of Godsmack in there. Maybe some of our songs, I feel a little Alice in Chains in there, maybe.
Yeah.
Because we're pretty happy about writing songs that don't sound like the previous one you just heard.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of variety in the music. So there's a lot of you know, swing from Godsmack to Alice in Chains and, like you said, Stone Temple Pilots. Maybe. Yeah, that's. That's where I think it lands.
Yeah, and again, it's like I see you guys' Facebook posts, and you're like me. When I see the kind of cars you like, the kind of cars I like, right? There's a certain age where it's like, that's metal, and that's, you know, this is either Fender metal or this is music metal that I consider sexy. This is what I like, right? So I'm going to ask you, when it comes to writing, was there a style, or is it across the board? How do you write?
I write kind of in reverse to what the norm is or what I understand the norm to be. So I write lyrically and melodically first. And then I kind of just go and imagine and try and learn what I just wrote in my head. So I'm always lyrics first, put a melody to the lyrics, go try and pick up an instrument and write from there. Brad does a lot of the writing, so his style is opposite.
Yeah. So
I think you need that, though, don't you? And
totally,
it's like, yeah.
Totally. The one thing that seems to work collectively for everybody is we'll bring an idea to the table, whether it's just a canvas, just with a rough sketch on it. Right, and then what we'll do is we'll just kind of put it down in a small demo format, and then everybody will take it, and all of a sudden Billy puts his personality, his twist into it, and then Dave will add his bit of nastiness to it, and Squigg will do his thing. So all of a sudden we're taking these component parts and we're just kind of making them work together.
Yeah,
it never usually ends up the way we started off.
Right, and you expect that too, right? You want it to be something different at the end of the day. I mean, Pete Townsend did that. He was pretty proficient as a drummer and a bass player. and he could sing okay. But he knew that those other guys were 10 times better than him, and they knew it. So he'd bring the demos, and then you'd get a fucking Who song out of it at the end of the day. And I think collaboration, where nobody gets butthurt, and everyone's like, yeah, if my buddy says, you know what, try this or do this, nobody's putting crossing their arms and fighting along the way. What's the point in that, right? So it's pretty easy. So you find it a good writing experience, writing together, right? Good. We're going to, we're going to play a track off of got some really great videos. You got some really great tunes that you're available now. If you're a fan of Sinburn already, check them out on Facebook, Twitter, anywhere else, Sinburn, you'll see that. Passion Play. Tell us about this tune.
Wow, Passion Play is it's a song that we jammed, Fudgehead and I, probably.
So it's a very riffy song, right? It's based on this infectious riff.
Yeah, so what happened was we started jamming this song years ago. Like, literally, Passion Play was around. It's been around for about 4.5 years. And then, so we just started adding to it and building it and building it. And then we got together with Squigg and then had some lyrics and some melody ideas. And we just wanted it to be, you know, just kind of really slutty and dirty kind of sounding. Mm-hmm. And so we just were, once we got Squigg on board and he kind of added his mechanisms to it, so to speak, then the song really kind of took life. And then Billy comes along and then just keeps adding more component parts. So we just start off with a basic format and then we just kind of build it and build it and build it. And the song has a great life to itself. So
it does.
And it's a fun song to play live, too.
I've heard it, and I heard it. I heard it over and over and over, and I liked it more and more every time. And I saw it being built. Great tune. Passion Play. Sinburn, right here at barbershoppodcast.com. At Barbershop Podcast, we do folk, we do blues, we do country, we do soul. If it's musical, if it's creative, if it's artistic, we do it. Now, speaking of artistic, let's talk about Hamilton. Let's talk about artistic. Let's talk about HamiltonArtists.ca. They are the number one place to go to get something printed on something. That's what they do, because they print anything on anything. You want to get Barbershop Podcast merch? You're a fan of the show? Go to HamiltonArtists.ca. Scroll down. You'll find it there along with a lot of other great Hamilton artists like Ginger St. James, Dwayne Rutter, Barbershop Podcast. That's the one you want anyway. Go there. Check them out. They're at 1141. They are moving this month. We're going to have a brand new ad at a brand new location. They are busting at the seams. They are so busy. Get a hold of them at 289-396-1653. If it's tiny, if it's big, I'm talking if it's you want cufflinks with your business on it, they'll do that. They have laser etching, right? So it's just as the Spock Star Trek machine. So you put it on and it burns it. You can do just, you know, pass the layer in your acoustic guitar, and you can put a without affecting the sound. It's just wonderful. And you can wrap your car, you can wrap your door, your business. I've seen them do whole storefronts. I've seen them do little things. Personal care attention. They are artists. They are friends of the show. HamiltonArtists.ca. Check them out. All right. Sinburn, we are checking you out. The Twitch TV. Check out Twitch TV. Twitch TV is lighting up right now. Busting at the seams. Ryan Cannon, is it like it's apparently it's going crazy in there. There is a whole whack of people on Twitch TV. You can check us. We do the show live. There's, you know, even though it seems incredibly slick and all put together after the fact, no, we do this live. All warts and blemishes kind of go out live and then go out after the fact as well. But if you want to see it as it happens, see it every Wednesday, sometime between 8 and 9 usually. www.twitch.tv/podcastbarber, something like that, right, Ryan Cannon? Yeah, he doesn't even have a microphone anymore. That's what happens with rock and roll. Like, a rock and roll man requires a lot of microphones, because a guy like Billy, you know, you don't want to miss one inch of Billy.
No.
So you got to mic the top of the. Yeah, there's a lot of Billy. It's hanging from up here to the floor, and you got to do the top of it. You got to mic the bottom of it. You got to mic the side of it.
Oh, you mean the kit?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, you were talking about your penis.
Again.
First penis stroke of the night. There it is.
How many songs in rock and roll have not been written about the penis? That should be the question. All right, let's talk about rock and roll. Let's talk about the very next song. That's going to be Killa, because we do live rock and roll here. I don't know. I had a piece of paper with it written on. Do you remember what you're going to play? No, I didn't. What are you going to play?
I'm going to play a song called Corrupt.
Corrupt. Now, in this day and age with the elections and the business and general discontent, people are corrupt. Is this a personal, universal story about someone you run into who's corrupt, or is it about
Brad? It's about all that. It's, if you listen to the lyrics, it's about voice of reason, confirmed by treason, and just everything that's just been kind of diabolical and devious, and you know, it's the
stir in the pot,
the bottle in the door, the gun behind the door kind of deal. So it's, there's so much goes on in the shadows, and it's just about corruption.
It's so true. It's so true. Follow the money. Barbershoppodcast.com.
Making you error. deprivation turns into desperation, and lawless is a happy dream. Seeded to power, immoral is your flower, deception is a seed you spread. How many times do you look just a seed? You're ended up in the ground. How many times do you bleed just a feel? This life may be corrupt, its burning wakes you up, and rips the moral base you stand on. You're never born corrupt, its hunger eats you up till everything you're holding close is gone. Is made with good intentions. You're living to fantasy.
Barbershop Podcast, giving you the very best in the live, original music, original musicians, real original people. That's what we purvey here, is natural ingredients. You know, you can get your processed shit over there, but here we do the real shit, and it is that good. If you are someone who dabbles in the music scene, please. Barbershop Podcast is announcing the month of June is going to be Bring Someone New to a Music Club in Hamilton Month. We're going to have a challenge here at Barbershop Podcast, and the idea is the person who brings at least one person who's never been to a live music show to a show in Hamilton will win an amazing prize pack that will guilt people, like some good people, some good stuff, into providing, and it'll be worth it. And the person who brings the most number of new people into the music scene, and we'll put that on a mailing list so these people will be able to see what kind of new music's going in there. We need new blood in the scene, and all we need to do, like, this is the sort of thing that if we believed in politics or we believed in, you know, Amway or whatever, we'd be like putting our friends in headlocks and dragging them out. But we tend to love, I mean, I think it's kind of like when you go out, it's like every time I go out to even. And this is another thing. Don't wait till you're in a good mood and everything's perfect to go out to a show. Go out when you feel shitty. Go out when your fucking body hurts. Go out when you only have $13, because probably you can get in and still get a beer, but the music will fix you. That's the idea. You go and the music is there to fix you. It's not... Yeah. Okay. Let's go to a CD track, because I have no camera. Barbershop Podcast, and Gary's going to tell us what it is, or he's going to allude to it. He knows what it is, and I don't. And this, Gary, send me some telepathic message so I don't have to. Angry! BarbershopPodcast.com. Rock and roll, I'm angry. Great song from Sinburn. Had some good work done here at BOXO Studio.
Yeah.
Glad you came in. Glad to have met their acquaintance and glad to check them out. Guy like Jimmy over the Corktown. He loves you guys and I've seen you play there a number of times. It's a great room.
Give him Jimmy it is. Right now. Guy,
Jimmy, some love right there. I love Jimmy at the Corktown Tavern.
Pajamas,
like to make that the rock room. You know, you don't specialize these rooms. I'll be like the dresser. Be like, Tuesday night, it is these guys from Montreal with our Hamilton accompaniment. And I've always said, city of this size has got one or two examples, world-class examples of everything. So I don't care if it's fashion design or whatever. And at the time, I was using restaurants, right? You don't have the plethora of Toronto. But my God, there's places that they don't have any pizza. And they have to get a frozen pizza. That's the only way they ever eat a pizza. And if you, like, threw a rock from this house, there's probably 12 pizza places you could hit. And that's just one corner of, you know, a city that if you had a craving for, you know, Laotian food or Indian food or what, you'll find one or you may not find 10, but Hamilton's got pretty good example of everything, right? And musically, it's the same way, isn't it? Like, tell me about your experience as being a Hamilton musician. What sets you apart? What makes being from this place making what you do better?
Well, as Sinburn, I think one of the differentiators that we like to believe exists is our performance, our live performance. I don't think we played a show where we haven't delivered everything we've got. And and that's evidenced by the next morning and how we feel.
It's true.
After a show.
And I've talked to a number of club owners after the fact, and it doesn't matter if you had 200 people that night or you had 25 people that night, the response is always the same, that you guys gave it and everyone in attendance had a great time.
We're lucky to be able to play on stage for no matter how many people are there, and I think we all appreciate that. So if it's one person or 1,000 people, we're going to deliver everything.
Yeah, but one person sucks, though, when it's one person.
It does, but unless that person it runs the greatest metal website ever in Sweden and just happened to be in Hamilton that night and fell in love. Even and it can happen.
The one thing that I appreciate about being a Hamilton musician is we're not that trendy treat of the week kind of band that you get from a lot of the bigger centers, a lot of the metropolis, all the Toronto bands. They all want to sound the same. Mm-hmm. And Hamilton, especially the way we do things, is we just like to do what we do best, what we love to do, and we just kind of do it our own way. You know, we don't try to follow, like Dave said earlier, we don't try to follow that cookie cut style or in a pattern of somebody else. We just do it our way, we do it.
Like the way it's
Yeah, there's so many musicians in Hamilton. I mean, I've played in many bands, and I've never had to travel once. I never had to go to Burlington, Toronto, Kitchener, wherever. There's always been somebody in Hamilton to play with. You know, there's so many musicians.
Yeah. It's truly rich, isn't it?
It's a very supportive community, too. Like, you look out in the crowd and, everybody's a musician.
And that's unfortunate, because this is what blows me away. It's almost like the original foodies didn't want all the fuckers to know about their restaurants, right? They only wanted the other foodies to go to these restaurants. And I think that's what exists in the Hamilton music scene right now, is there's a whole bunch of people who are like, I don't want to share this with the general public, because I guarantee you the general public, and I just people bringing CDs, right? We've done in 3 years 183 shows. So upstairs I have, let's assume, 183 CDs, and that's only, you know, 30 months worth of material. Now let's go back 30 years.
Yeah.
Like, how many bodies of work exist that no one's had the opportunity to even hear?
Right.
And then you think about the stuff that made it all the way through a studio and never got released. Or then you think about the stuff that's sitting in great, you know, the stages. Like, I think a Spotify for the city of Hamilton was like a remarkable idea. You know, these are kind of crazy ideas I get. You know, the city makes like a kibitz, which is like a Hamilton Spotify. And you get your ass, your song up there. If you can download it, it's up there. And I'm sorry, but if you pay taxes in this area, you can be on it. If not, sorry. You know, it's like maybe Burlington or you know, these people can, but absolutely Flamborough, absolutely Dundas, absolutely Ancaster, mm-hmm. absolutely Stony Creek, right? We are Hamilton now. Put that together so people are like, you know, all I know is Hamilton's kick-ass. Go on there. Instead of making 1/1600th of a cent or whatever a Spotify, maybe it would be like 25 cents. Like, who knows? But I think the it just constantly kills me that there's a product and there's a market and there's a choke point in between, and that, that people are just constantly like, I didn't even know this existed. Well, whose responsibility is that, right? You can't go up and down the street and knock on every door and say, can we play a set on your front porch?
Yeah.
You think we're pretty good, right? do what you can. So you support the people like us who do what we can do to bring it to you. And I honestly believe exactly what they said. You look in the audience and they're musicians. So these are people who right off the bat, I mean, they're not rich, you know? They can't be, and I lost so many great musicians to real estate and educational system and got jobs as teachers or whatever. Musicians ain't dumb people. They're smart people. They can do, even people who work full time. Think another great idea, see Hamilton, an employment agency where it's staffed by only musicians, right? Because goddamn, if you're a musician, you're either a mechanic or a house painter or a caretaker or something, right? And it's like you can get an employment outside of the field, but to pursue music full time is a dedication. You got to do it, you got to mean it, you got to feel it. And I don't know any other fucking job, I mean, in the arts in general, but music for sure.
Yeah, and it's the only industry where everybody expects you to play for free for exposure.
Yeah, and it's like, and you're the top 1% of your craft, and you're making less than a security guard gets paid to watch a gate.
Yeah.
I mean, a job a monkey could do, like seriously. And that's like to ask for $10 an hour. I mean, and we're all old enough to remember where it's like everyone made $500 a night. I mean, that was like an idiot made $500 a night. Now you gotta be the Rolling Stones. Make $500 a night in this town. So even more reason to go out, because the people doing it aren't doing it for the money. They're doing it because they love it. They're doing it because they got to do it. Another little flavor of that, another little taste of that. We're going to hear some music. We're going to do a live one? Are we up for a live one? Are we up for a, what's a...
We're always up for a live one.
Always up for a live one.
Sure. I can't remember what order we're in.
We got a live one here.
Let's do another live one. What are you going to sing for us?
We'll do a song called I You Know.
Love it.
But I just want to comment on this song.
Okay, it's got a
backstory. This is a song that this man wrote years ago, and it was a completely different song. It was a very, very slow, dark...
You probably have a great demo of
dark
that.
Dark ballad. Yeah. Oh, we do. it was a really slow, dark ballad, versions. And we played with it a couple of times, and it just never came to the surface. And then, so we started messing with it again, just different tuning, sped it up, heavied it up, and it just has such an intense darkness. It's such a great song. But it's very important, because I just want to acknowledge that there was a lot of work, and this song has come from so many different stages, from years of effort that Squigg put into it. So, well, and then
so
these guys...
Kind of defines your existence with this band, because they all came together on this.
Yeah. You know, this is a perfect culmination of everybody putting in their style and their emphasis into the song to make it what it is right now.
That's what I love about it. It's like the greatest form of communication in the world. And it's right in your face. And it's right here, right now, at barbershoppodcast.com.
You're dancing on my brain. Every day and night, I wanna tell you about. And you're doing to me every day and night. You leave me breathless and numb.
feel the things I feel when you lay under the same old that I look at the CD. Can you hear me call your name when you're alone? Are you still talking to me? Does your body ache when I'm gone? Oh, would you tell me? Well, does your temperature rise at? Isn't you free when you are running through your daily routine? Do you hunger with all that you are, with every fantasy, with every ounce of your being? Are you missing me when I'm gone? Oh, would you tell me? Your sweat to make me come alive. I know. Where do we go from here?
Like they said, dark like the night, dancing on my grave. That is Sinburn, metal from Hamilton, Ontario. Now, we have a tradition here in the Hammer, and that is that music, if it has any fakery whatsoever, tends to be dusted and escorted out the door by security with its contents of its desk in a cardboard box. I'm going to ask you about the business, and it's a tough thing, and especially guys, and I don't want to, I see the millennials, for example, you know, they'll come in, they're at a band, the Bandicoots are on last week, young guys. Music was like almost like a video game where it's something that they could do, but it caught their fancy and they're good at it. They liked it just like us. Absolutely legitimate, but come from where it wasn't the one thing. It wasn't hanging and glowing in front of us. It's like, that's how you get pussy. You know, it's like now it's like there's all these other distractions in the world. I'm always happy to see young music coming out. I'm going to ask you when you're like making it and hacking it at, in the music business and doing it yourself. When I did it, I always loved doing the other shit. Other people hate doing the other shit. What parts of the business do you love and what parts of the business do you hate?
Oh,
you see that one?
You could take, you could go nuts on this if you want. Pass it off to Brad. He'll go.
I can tell you what I love, and that's performing.
Yeah.
I mean, if that
everyone
is,
says if that is true.
Part of, if that is part of the business, which I believe it is, although it's more of a pleasure.
No, it has to be. You don't have a product if you don't have a live performance.
I love being on stage. I love looking out, and I love performing for people. That's
because
that's
people don't realize, even though this, the Beatles were never played live after 1966, they were strictly a studio band. How did they get there? Yeah, how did they get to the point where they could afford to do nothing but studio music? They were the greatest fucking live band ever, right? It's like they paid their dues, yeah. Paid a million live shows. So it's hard for the casual fan who's a music fan, but maybe, you know, goes to the Pink show and then maybe goes to the Eagles reunion, and that's their $1,000 that they have for a 10-year investment in going and seeing live music. Live, like, big name acts are super expensive,
yeah,
to go to and hard to get into, and yet there's a hunger for it.
$5 ticket.
You got to remember that you can get real live music like pretty much every night of the week, right? So I want to, each one of you guys, before we play something else, another vid, I think we got a video coming up. I want you to tell me about the first time, like, you either snuck in somewhere or when you were young, like I'm talking 17, 18, 19, where you saw a live show where you'd already seen live music, but this was like a facial rearrangement. Like, tell me about the first facial rearrangement show.
I saw Gatto
at
the Galaxy Club in Oakville. It was the walking distance from where I used to live, and I went down there. It was my first rock show. Blew my freaking mind. Yeah. Gino Scarpelli and Greg Godovitz and the other guy. And
had no idea like that could exist.
No, it was just mind-blowing. And they had some band called The Blitz open. Like, yeah. And this is, so I was, you know, super young, and I'm not anymore, so it was a long time ago, you know, and I remember it like it was, you know, the thing they say.
Yesterday.
Exactly.
It's so true. Billy, what was your first, like, facial rearrangement rock and roll experience?
First concert ever, 13 years old, I saw Motley Crue at Maple Leaf Gardens, which was, it was pretty wow, but as I got a little bit older, you know, grew the hair longer, I think it was Metallica that was... rip my face off, kind of thing. Yeah, I had whiplash the next day.
Yeah,
because, so I'm at the C&E.
And your cheeks hurt because you smiled like so much, like that night.
Incredible.
And, like, I'm serious. Like, if people who are casual, you don't have to do that. That's what I'm getting at. Yeah. You know, $10-$15. You know, you go out free on a lot of nights. You go out, you can see real live original music.
Yeah.
Brad, what was your like first show? I was already a music fan, but you're young enough where it was like, wow, that took it to a whole another level.
Yeah, there's a couple things. When I was 17, my brother's maybe about 18 months older than me. And so sometimes I'd steal his ID and I'd go into the bar. And so we went into this local club. Sorry, Mom, it's true. Anyways, so we'd go into this local bar in North Bay and I'd go and see these cover bands play. And they were up there doing, you know, all these 80s hair bands. And I was just so awestruck by them. I just thought, like, these guys were just gods.
Yeah.
It was so cool.
Yeah.
And that really, really kind of motivated me. And we'd catch a bus and we'd come down to Exhibition Grounds. We saw Judas Priest and Crocus. It was the first big concert I ever saw. And it was just, and we were on the floors at that time. I don't know how we got them. But it was just, it was.
And
just,
you could afford it at the
it
time, right?
It was the most
right?
mind-blowing experience I've ever seen. I mean, just to see, you know, like the metal gods, yeah. Rob Halford. And
oh, my God.
It was amazing. It was amazing.
My God, that's killer. And that's what, like, Kingswood was like in the day. Like, they had some amazing shows. I would love to see a full list of everyone who played Kingswood, because it's like, there's some great names. What was yours?
My answers are going to start getting boring.
Kiss.
Yeah. Play for you.
1982. I was 11 years old, and my mom brought me to my first Kiss concert. It was the Creatures of the Night tour.
That's hot.
And isn't it sexy. She brought, and it was a first concert band I was at the time just in the midst of growing up loving. And
my mom tolerated my love of Kiss, but she would. I don't think she would have taken. My father did. I had a Dynasty when that came out. It skipped. And my dad drove all the way back to Buffalo from Fort Erie, so they would give me another record.
I got a funny Dynasty story.
Do you?
I used to own.
Here we go.
Great. Let's play some.
We're going down the drain.
That's it. It all starts here.
I actually traded Rush Fly By Night for Kiss Dynasty.
You did?
Yeah, that was probably the best trade ever made. It was awesome.
Love it. Yeah. They call it cock rock. They call it LA rock. They call it in your face rock. I don't know. I love it.
Rock.
Exactly. In the 80s, when there was a dearth, when the guitar was similarly extracted from rock and roll. They tried to digitalize it. They tried to, every drum had a huge gate on it. It had tons of reverb on it. They tried to make it sound as unlike a primal instrument as possible. You know what? Rock and roll still stuck its little face out. And when something like Appetite for Destruction came out, or Dr. Feelgood came out, these were things where the young rocker is wondering if his quest that he, you know, Ozzy and Rush had set for him was a lie. And then these great young bands, not the ones you love, because they're playing keyboards, they're trying to stay current.
Yeah.
Someone else comes out who was inspired by them, play some fucking real rock and roll, and now they're the demigods. Let that be a lesson to you. Stick to your guns. You know, even if your guns are changing with the times, be current with yourself. All right, we've got a we got a video. Ryan, what are we playing? I've lost my little cheat sheet. Never Bleed Again. That's also known as menopause, right here. Barbershoppodcast.com.
We'll be right back.
Gotta love a good, hardworking rock and roll band, especially if they're out of Hamilton, Ontario, which is where we are. Gonna have a little finish of the night, back-to-back, double shot, live music. What are you gonna do for us?
We'll do a couple tunes. We'll do Lycan, and we'll do a song called My Tragedy.
All right. I know there's a lot of people out there have been liking My Tragedy. We're going to hear them both right here, right now, barbershoppodcast.com.
It's slowly slipping from me, it's hard to breathe. This darkness holds me tight, I'm on my knees. I feel it ripping through me, I start to see through these blackened eyes. I am the creature of this creation, blood of the ancient hunter. I embrace the darkness, passion is heartless. Surrender to this lichen. Massive beast on silent steps, I'm watching from above. Peering out beyond the dark, I'm begging by your hope. Reality is slowly slipping from me. It's hard to breathe. This darkness holds me tight. I'm on my knees. I feel it ripping through me. I start to see through these blackened eyes. I am the creature of this creation, blood of the ancient hunter. I embrace the darkness, passion is heartless. Surrender to this lichened eye.
Drop down on a fucking solid mass of incremental believing. I'm smiling, watch you carry on. Push comes to goddamn shoving through an undeniable feeling. One back step forward and you're gone. Yeah. Five finger discount rip off swinging from a twisted ceiling. Fire up your engine, let her go. Three-ton electric explosive, suck it down and get me screaming. Tongue-tied and tangled down below. I know you, what you want me to be. I want you, fuck away from me. I am you, a broken melody. I made you, my tragedy. I believe. Making what you need. We all feed from your screen. Happy, relentlessly deceived. We all feed from your screen. Tripped up beyond stone sober while they're hammering beside you. I drip with all the spit you need. Head banging, waking the neighbors, screaming louder than the volume. Good God, what the motherfuck can it be? I know you, what you want me to be. I want you, fuck away from me, yeah. I and you, a broken melody. I made you, my tragedy. Making what you need. We all feed from your screen. Empty, relentlessly deceived. Yeah, we all feed from your screen. Part of the song, and when we perform it live, we take this opportunity to introduce the band. So as you know, that's AFB on the bass guitar. This is Brad Foisy on the electric guitar. That's Billy Spencer on the drums. And I'm just some guy they call Squigg. But most importantly, what we do at this point in our show is we thank each and every one of you for coming out to see us and for making something like this possible. So we want to equally thank you for being here and watching us tonight. We're going to see you real fucking soon. Check you out. Now let's get a little crazy. Ready? Let's go!
Wicked good, explosive, original rock and roll metal from Hamilton, Ontario. Sinburn for Ryan Cannon, Gary Greenland, all the good people of this wonderful city. Hoping you come out and join us for some live music this week, next week. Make it happen. Make yourself happy every week right here barbershoppodcast.com. Thanks so much, guys.
Yeah.
See ya.
Rock and roll.